G'day, my name's Brent. Today I'm running an example of Magic Realm Play. It's a one-month solo game for everyone's favourite bad boy, the Black Knight. I'm going to be running this game a little bit different to much probably standard Black Knight play because I'm playing with Knight's Adjustment and Watchful Natives, which I think is creates an interesting challenge for this character. So I'm playing with both of those third edition optional rules. I'm not playing with any other optional rules which might affect this game. Okay, the Black Knight. Really a real iconic character, not just for this game, but for fantasy literature in general, and also for Monty Python, although this Black Knight has a few more limbs than the Monty Python version, which is a good thing, because we actually need to be able to move around and fight. He's a very interesting character. I love his symbol, Mars, God of War, and I think that says everything, because that's what the Black Knight is all about. Ruthless and cold-blooded war. He's easy to forget, and I always think of him as a heavy character because of his heavy armor, but of course he's not. He's medium vulnerability. So if and when he loses his armor, he's as vulnerable as the wizard and the sorcerer. He's got medium vulnerability, but hopefully we won't ever be exposed to an embarrassing death from an imp with our medium vulnerability, but he is has medium vulnerability. Of course, the Knight's Adjustment means that, very importantly, he's not allies with the company. The company moved to friendly status because of the Knight's Adjustment, which means that the very strong strategy of hanging around the inn or one of the campfires waiting for the company to turn up and then hiring them possibly for free on a boon is not possible. You can do it, but you're going to have to basically strip down naked to do it and sell off all your equipment. And that's a viable thing to do, but also a little bit dangerous, especially if you're not playing solo, because it's very easy for characters to target you and take you out and ignore your hired natives completely. So that really changes the complexion of the game for the Black Knight, and he's going to have to work a bit harder at achieving his dastardly ends. But just looking at the rest of him, his special advantages. His aim special advantage doesn't come into play that often in a one-month solo game. It's very unlikely to get his hands on a missile weapon. It's not impossible. Anything can happen in the realm, but that's kind of unlikely. However, his second special advantage, fear, I believe is possibly one of the strongest special advantages in the game. Rolling one die on instead of two on all the meeting table die rolls changes that top-heavy probability curve of the double dice roll in Magic Realm to a flat probability across the right across the table you're rolling on, which means that a result of one, which is usually the best result, is just as probable as a result of six, which is usually the worst result. That's one of the reasons that rolling on the allied table dealing with the company was such a problem for balance, I guess, in the game, because the Black Knight has a 1 in 6 chance instead of a 1 in 36 chance of actually hiring them on a boon for free, which I think is a little bit too strong. Now, if you're just starting out with the Black Knight and just learning to use natives, don't play with the... my advice would be not to play with the Knight's Adjustment, because it's a really strong strategy to go and find the company and hire them and get some experience leading hired natives. So by all means, don't use this. But once you've had a little bit of opportunity to play with the Black Knight and get used to him, I'd highly recommend the extra challenge of playing with Knight's Adjustment, which is what we'll be doing. Now, it's still not impossible for him to find the company and hire them, but he's going to have to do a bit of work first if he's going to do that. The other thing which really defines the Black Knight's character is his starting equipment. He's the most heavily armoured character in the game. Starts with full heavy armor and a shield. He also, his mace, his humble mace, is a very important feature of the Black Knight. It's a short weapon that is medium with no sharpness star, but it can be overswung with his heavy fight chits. And the wonderful feature about the mace is its alerted fight time of 3, which means he can swing it very fast. And it's the ideal weapon for taking out heavy monsters, particularly heavy armoured monsters, in particular the trolls, dragons, and the great swordsmen. And that's very important for how we're going to play this game, because the Black Knight is going to go looking for his enemy, the guard, who are all great swordsmen. And I think the mace, more than anything else, dictates the early strategy of the strategy of your early phases of play with the Black Knight. And it's actually a great weapon. I hope we get our hands on another weapon as well, but it's a great primary weapon for the Black Knight. He has a good selection of move and fight chits. He's not particularly fast. He can move at heavy 4, and that's a very important chit for the Black Knight, but he fatigues very quickly while he's doing that, so he's got to get his business done in the first couple of rounds of combat if he's depending on that move chit. I find it very interesting that he has medium move chits. I guess that's there to give him some options if he loses his heavy armor, whether he picks up lighter armor or has no armor at all if it's destroyed in play. But it almost invites you to sell off his armor for purposes of hiring or buying other equipment. So I find that very interesting. He has a number of heavy fight chits with which he can overswing his mace as well. So it's enough talking. Let's get on with it. His only choice of starting location is the inn. There's another number of options for victory points. I'm not a big fan of great treasures. Gold is difficult because the Black Knight has a lot of debt to pay off. He starts with expensive armor and mace and a starting purse of 10 gold. We'll just have a look at that. And he has to offset that before he can even start proceeding towards his victory requirement with gold if he takes it. So to earn one victory point in gold, he's going to have 70 gold in his purse at the end of the game. So we have to remember that. But we are planning to assault some natives, which means we can expect to pick up some loot, and he's well capable of reaching that 70 gold purse by the end of the game. So I'm going to take one gold. If we're taking on natives, and I've hinted that we might be doing that, then notoriety is a good choice. And I think we'll just take the 2 for 40 notoriety and 2 fame for 20 fame. And that rounds out our 5 victory points that was required for a 1-month solo game, or a 1-month game rather. We'll randomly place mission chits and let's have a look at the realm. Now, where are we? We're down here in the southwest corner of the realm. Now, the first thing I want to find out is where the guard are, and they're all the way over here in the east. Long way to get to them. We're going to have to go through all these mountain clearings in High Pass, through these caves in Borderland. Down through deep woods, through these woods, through mountain, through the ghosts to get there. It might not be worth doing. What I think I'll do in this case is start heading off in that direction. We'll see what we encounter on the way. Now, getting across the High Pass is a bit of a difficult proposition. We've got a couple of difficult tiles to get through. I believe in principle you should never move into a tile without an unknown tile, when you don't know what chits are there and what monsters might be summoned, without hiding. The problem with High Pass is that it takes 2 phases to move into every clearing, and we only have 4 phases per day. So if I hide, I'm going to move, hide, move, hide, move, hide, move, hide. It's going to take 4 days for us to get through High Pass. That's too long. I'm going to take the risk of moving in without hiding. That will take all 4 phases to move into those 2 mountain clearings. Risky, risky stuff. Monster die roll of 4. Otherwise, we'll be here forever and never achieve our victory conditions. Luck nothing summoned to our clearing. Let's see what is here. A sound chit and a warning chit. The warning chit is Smoke Sea. Smoke Sea sounds like dragons, and it is. Heavy armoured dragons, and then a tremendous dragon for the subsequent roll. Now, as I've said, heavy armoured dragons are an excellent opponent for us. Maneuver time of 4 that can be undercut by our mace. Heavy dragons, I'm not afraid of. Same heavy trolls on that roll of 4 for Roar. They've actually appeared, but they haven't appeared in our clearing. They've appeared in the clearing with the sound chit. So they could prowl across on another roll of 4. The tremendous troll I would hate to see. He's beyond my killing range. He's now because I can't do tremendous damage. Over swinging my mace, the best I can do is heavy. But if he's summoned on another roll of 4, then he will be summoned to that sound chit again. And as long as I don't go into that clearing with the Roar, don't stay in that clearing with the Roar sound chit, I'm going to have to pass through it, but as long as I don't stay in that clearing for long, I should be able to get away from him. I'm going to have to pass through anyway, so I've got no choice. What I do know is that if I take on these heavy trolls, if I move it straight into here now, I'll be blocked by them immediately if I'm unhidden. So I'm going to have to hide before I move in if I want to record any phases. And once I've done that, I can either choose to take them on, or and it would be better to do that from a position of hiding, or I can choose not to take them on if I'm hidden. Chance of hiding successfully on the hide table is 70%. If I roll a 6, that's a 30% chance I won't be hidden. That chance increases to 91% if I roll 2 hides. And as there's nothing in my clearing, I can afford to perform 2 hides. I won't be blocked if I do it, so I can perform 2 hides before moving in there, move into there, and hopefully there's only a very small chance that I won't be hidden when I arrive in that clearing. Of course, I don't have enough phases to move through to 2 high pass because I must hide, otherwise I'd be blocked if I moved in there. So record 2 hide phases, 91% chance of hiding, and move into the clearing with the heavy trolls. Let's see what happens. I succeeded on the first anyway on a roll of 2, so the second one wasn't required, and I've moved into high pass. Now, I'm actually going to attempt to take out these heavy trolls. There's an advantage of doing that from hiding, is that I can actually attack, get a free attack on one of them, and I can do it with my alerted mace. Now, I could have alerted my mace as a phase, but I would have had to drop one of those hide rolls, and the advantage of going in hidden is that I'll be able to alert the mace in the encounter step of combat, which is good. These heavy trolls, they are heavy and armoured, so I can deal with them by overswinging my mace to do heavy damage. It doesn't have a sharpness star, so it won't lose any of its impact whatsoever. They do a medium 4 attack, which won't hurt me at all, which is good. All it would do, if it impacted my shield, it would damage it. If it impacted my armor, it wouldn't do anything. It would just wound me through it. On their far other side, of course, they've got the same maneuver time, but they do a heavy attack. It's a slow heavy attack, but that could actually damage my armor. And once again, of course, it would wound me. It would actually destroy my shield. So I would elect to inactivate that if I can for this combat, because it does nothing at all. The only thing that shield... Oh, actually, no, it could protect my heavy armor from one of their heavy blows. So no, I actually will keep it activated. But the first thing I'm going to do in the encounter phase, nice and hidden, is activate my mace. I've done that with my medium 5 chit, which I don't need. So I've done it with my fight heavy 6 chit, which I didn't mean to do. I should have used my medium chit, which I wouldn't have to use this round. I can wait another round, but my mace is longer than their, it's got a length of 1, so it's longer than their time of naught, which means it will hit first in this round, and I'm not going to be attacked by them if I swing attack them this round. Watchful natives doesn't apply to monsters, so since we're past the assignment phase, they don't get an attack on me if I swing, and I'm actually guaranteed to kill one of them because I know I can undercut them with automatically with my mace's alerted time of 3, and they will not be able to manoeuvre away from that, even if they change tactics, and I can guarantee I do enough damage. So that's the advantage of attacking from hiding, is that I get a free attack that guarantees to kill one of these trolls. The Black Knight is very effective against heavy trolls. As soon as I select a target, I'll be unhidden, but the other one, neither of them will be assigned to me because I was hidden during the encounter step, or during the assignment step. Now, all I have to do is play a heavy chit. I've played a heavy 6 chit. If I play a heavy 5 chit, I'll have only played 1 asterisk and I won't have to fatigue. It doesn't matter what the time on it is, it only matters that it's heavy, so I'll overswing the medium mace for heavy damage. Dead troll, guaranteed kill. That's excellent. Now, I have another troll to face. What do I do here? This heavy troll will be assigned to attack me. It's possible, therefore, that he will destroy my shield, or if he manages to intercept me, or damage my armor if he intercepts my armor directly with his heavy attack, and I don't want either of that to happen. I'd rather just kill him. However, my mace is unalerted, and my heaviest fight time, heavy 4, is my fastest heavy chit. And of course, I have to use a heavy chit. So even at maximum fatiguing with that chit, the best I'll be able to do is an attack time of 4, which will not undercut the heavy troll, so I won't guarantee a kill. So what I should probably do is alert my weapon again. Now, the only way I can do that is play a chit which is faster than the maneuver time of this heavy troll who's now on my sheet. When they weren't on my sheet, when I was hidden, I could play any old chit I liked. But now that he's on my sheet, because I'm unhidden, I have to play a faster fight maneuver counter to alert my weapon in the encounter phase than his maneuver time. The only one I have is my fight medium 3 chit. If I have to swing this mace with a time of 3, why bother and not just use this? The reason is it's a medium chit, and I have to use a heavy chit. And my fastest heavy chit is 4. So I want that time of 3, and I'm willing to sacrifice and use all of my effort in the encounter step, because I've now used all my effort asterisks that I'm allowed to use, to alert alert my mace. And that's done. That fight medium 3 chit's gone to the use this round box, and I can't use any more effort asterisks now. That might look like a problem, but I've got this troll in the bag, with the expense of just having fatigued a fight chit. The reason is that I can now swing with this heavy 6 chit. Doesn't matter what its time is, but it's the heavy chit I need to overswing to kill it. But my fight time's 3. I'm guaranteed to undercut it and kill it. And now that we're on the second round of combat, fastest fight times hit first. Its very fastest fight time it can do is a fight time of 4. So I'm going to kill it before it can even hit me at all. There's no point in my playing maneuver. It's dead. So attacking from ambush with at the expense of fatiguing 1 asterisk fight counter, which I'll do as a fight M4, has given me a 2 troll kill, and there was absolutely guaranteed that that result was going to happen. So they're an excellent opponent for the Black Knight to ambush from hiding. Notice I got 15 fame and 15 notoriety. They're worth 5 fame and 5 notoriety each, but the second one for the day, of course, is worth double because I killed him in the same day. So 15 fame, 15 notoriety, which is a fantastic start. I've almost got my fame just on the end of day 3. All right, now I will need to remember that I need to rest that medium 4 fight counter, but I do have another one, and I'm actually very keen to... I will be resting at this turn anyway. I'd said I was very keen to get out of the mountains, but the next place I'll have to move, of course, is into a cave clearing in Borderland, and I won't be able to because I'm limited to 2 phases once I enter a cave. I'll have already used 2 phases to get into 2 high pass. So on day 4, I'll move there. I'll hide just in case those dragons turn up. I know I can take them, but of course, it's the same with the trolls. It will be better if I attack them from hiding. And I might as well use... I've got an extra phase now. I could use it for an extra hide, but I'm not too scared if the dragons turn up, even if I'm not hidden. So I might as well use it to rest back that chit. Done. Monster roll of 5. Dragons are 1, so no dragons turning up. Good. Now, I'm still heading on my way to the Guard. I've managed to accrue fame and notoriety on my way there, so I think that's a good outcome. I do want to get there quickly. I've only limited two phases when I move into the caves in Borderlands, so I could move one hide, move one hide, move one hide. I rather really just get through and get out, get through those Borderlands as quickly as possible. Moving into cave clearings, there is a possibility of summoning goblins. Half a dozen goblins would be half a dozen axe goblins. These are the ones I'm most worried about. Half a dozen axe goblins, of course, many dangerous things could turn up, but these are the things I always think about in caves. I can actually take on half a dozen axe goblins. I'd probably get hurt, but I would probably survive. So I'm happy to take the risk. This, again, this is not necessarily good teaching to do this, but we've found ourselves in a sticky situation if we were going to get through in any decent time to get out. And it's going to take me a lot of days to get through here. And of course, the longer I spend in here, the more chance I've got of summoning monsters. So I'm going to take the risk of getting through as quickly as possible. Monster die roll of one, which is not goblins. They come on a three. Nothing summoned in my clearing. So I made a good, safe choice. What do we have here? Danksian Cairns. Danksi's the warning chit. Cairns is a treasure site. Danksi, serpents. Two heavy serpents. I can kill them. They're not quite as good as the heavy dragons and the tremendous troll because they've got a maneuver time of three, so I can't undercut them. That's a more dangerous fight for me, but I can take them on. I can't touch the tremendous serpent. He's beyond my killing range, but he won't be the first one summoned. It'll be heavy serpents. So I know that a tremendous serpent won't come first up. The Cairns is a treasure site, which is interesting. Tremendous spider. He's also beyond my killing range with the mace, and he's fast and maneuverable, so he would be a dangerous opponent. But he will be summoned to the Cairns site, and if I don't go into the Cairns site, then originally at least I'm safe. He won't land, be summoned immediately onto me. And if he is summoned, at least I'll know he's there and I can take measures to avoid him. So there is a treasure site there as well, which is the Cairns, which is ripe for looting. It's quite a rich treasure site. It has seven treasures, but you do have to fatigue to do that, and that means a lot of resting. And unfortunately, it's a cave clearing, which would limit me to two search phases per turn. I'm not desperately keen to loot that Cairns, and I have business with the Guard elsewhere, so I'm going to ignore that. I'm just going to move through and try and get out of this tile as quickly as possible. If I move out, I know the only thing that can be summoned to me are the heavy serpents, and I know I can take care of them. I prefer not to face them because of their fast maneuver time, but I know that I can actually face them with some chance of success if they do appear, so I'm going to do that. And once again, I'm going to take the risk of not hiding. It's less of a risk now because I know I have a fairly good idea of what I could face. There's a 1 in 6 chance that a monster I can handle will come to my clearing. And that's a safe move. And it's happened. There you go. Monster die roll of two. The two heavy serpents appeared. I didn't necessarily want that to happen, and I've taken the risk, but it wasn't a tremendous monster I couldn't deal with. I knew that I could take these, and it was a calculated risk. I might lose armor here. Let's look at the heavy serpents. The worry about them, of course, is that I can't undercut them. And I'm unhidden anyway, so I'm going to be attacking with an unalerted mace first round anyway. It wouldn't make a difference. They only do medium damage. That can damage my shield. It can't do anything to my heavy armor. Of course, if they hit me with that, it will wound me. On their other side, they're a bit more dangerous because they have a heavy 5 attack, which is slow, but it could damage my heavy armor. However, I'm not too worried about them turning over because they actually have a maneuver time of 4. And once they turn to that side, I can undercut them to kill them. So it's an interesting combat. I'm going to leave my shield activated because if they turn to their heavy sides, I don't want them to damage my heavy armor, and I'd much prefer they impacted my shield. Good. All right, in the activate-inactivate stage, I can't actually alert my mace. If we look, it won't let me, because I don't have a fight time faster than a maneuver time of 3. The only other thing I might be able to do is activate or inactivate armor, and as I've said, I'm not going to do that. So my target is one of the heavy serpents. It doesn't matter which, they're identical. They've got a 2 in 3 chance of hitting me. My weapon length is longer, so if I hit them, no matter what fight speed I play, if I hit, manage to intercept a heavy serpent in this first round of combat, my hit will go through first. So I can actually afford to play a slow fight chit. I have to play heavy because they're armoured. I have to overswing my medium mace for heavy damage, but I know my length, weapon length of 1 is longer than their weapon length of 0. So in this first round of combat, if I intercept my target, I'm going to hit him before he hits me. So what I'm going to do is protect my maneuver with my attack. What does that mean? That means that if, because of course the serpents defend and attack in the same direction, unlike characters, they have to defend and attack in the same direction. If I intercept him, if he intercepts me, I also intercept him if I play my maneuver there. And my attack is guaranteed to kill him before his gets through. It means my maneuver is protected. He won't hurt me. If I play my move heavy 4, I'm guaranteed that they won't wound me. So if I played the heavy 5 or heavy 6, then they would undercut me. Even though those medium attacks couldn't get through my armor, they would still cause me wounds because a hit of medium or greater weight causes a wound through armor. So I'm going to play, I'd rather fatigue 1 asterisk than risk 2 wounds. So I'm going to play my move heavy 4. If they flip, of course, to their heavy 5 side, that won't matter. So I know that I'm probably not going to get injured here. There's a 1 in 3 chance that the serpent I'm not attacking will move into thrust box, in which case I won't hit my intended target and my shield will either be damaged or destroyed and I'll take a wound. So there's a 1 in 3 chance of that, a 1 in 3 chance that they'll all manoeuvre completely out of my attack box, and a 1 in 3 chance I'll actually get my target. Okay, it was the worst result possible. My target moved, so I didn't intercept him. And he flipped, so he's now slow enough for me to get with my alerted mace, but he's dangerous because he can damage my armour. My target I wasn't getting did that 1 in 3 repositioning chance, impacted my shield, which damaged it with that medium. If he'd flipped, he would have destroyed it with his heavy damage, but luckily he didn't. And I actually take a wound because a medium attack has impacted my armour. So I've got an aching shield arm. The advantage of this now, however, is that my mace has missed and it's now alerted. I'll fatigue that move medium 4 counter, which I can't use. I had to do that because if I used a move heavy 4. You can see this is a harder. Attacking these two serpents from an unhidden position is much more dangerous than having attacked the trolls from a hidden position. And I think these are a more dangerous opponent than the trolls because of their fast manoeuvre times. All right, I now need to wound a chit, any chit. That move medium 5 is a good candidate, just the same as it was against the... I haven't done that yet. The move medium 4 is a good one to fatigue because I can't use it with my heavy armour. Move medium 5 is a good one to wound for the same reason. I'd actually prefer when I wound to wound chits that don't have an effort asterisk because they are easier to heal. A chit with no effort asterisk can't be fatigued, so it goes one rest will take it straight back from wounded to active. If it had an effort asterisk, it would take one rest to get it back to fatigued and then one rest to get it back to active. So it's the best chit to wound, and because it's medium 5, of course, I can't use that with my heavy armor. It's useless to me in this combat. It's the best one to wound. So that's done. I didn't hit them. I'm fatigued and wounded, but one of them has changed tactics and my weapon is now alerted. My damage shield was damaged too. What that means is that I can undercut this heavy serpent. Now, he might change tactics back to his 3 manoeuvre side, in which case I won't undercut him with my mace, but there's only a 30% chance of that happening. 70% chance he'll stay on that side, and that's good odds. So I'll go with the odds and attack the one who A, is more dangerous because of his heavy attack, and B, I can actually undercut if he stays on that side. Once again, I'll protect my maneuver because of my fast attack time. Now, the fastest attack time now hits first in subsequent rounds, and as fate would have it, I've got an attack time of 3, which will be faster than them no matter which side they flip to. So once again, it's worth protecting my maneuver with my attack, so that if I'm intercepted, and they'll have to intercept me, they can't undercut me on either side, my mace will get through. 1 in 3 chance this heavy serpent will move up here and do the same as happened last turn, but 1 in 3 chance my serpent will stay here. Even if he doesn't stay here, if he doesn't change tactics, I'll undercut him. This is the best play we could make out of this. And this time it worked. He didn't move, so this heavy serpent didn't move to intercept me. I undercut and intercepted this heavy serpent. Medium, overswung for heavy damage. His armor's irrelevant because no sharpness stars are involved. That's another reason the mace is so nice against these opponents, as opposed to, say, something like the short sword. And he dies. He would have intercepted me, despite my fast maneuver time, because he was in this box, but I protected my maneuver with my attack, because my attack time was faster than his. He died before he got through. Dead serpent. 4 fame and 4 notoriety. I'll have to fatigue on asterisk move counter. I need that heavy 4, so I'm going to fatigue my move heavy 5. Now, there's a problem. I can't undercut this heavy serpent, and I can't play a fight time that's faster than his 3. I also, next fatiguing of a move counter is going to be my heavy 4 move chit, because I've fatigued all my other asterisk move chits. So this is what happens to the Black Knight when he has to start using his heavy 4 chit. He fatigues very easily. So what do I do now? Well, I have to target this heavy serpent. I can't alert my... couldn't alert my weapon chit in the action phase, in the encounter phase. So I'm going to have to swing heavy to attempt to get him, and the very best I can do is heavy 5. Now, if I miss him this round, my weapon will become alerted, and I'll have a reasonable chance of undercutting him. Do I play my heavy 4 fight counter now? If I do that, I'm going to have to play the heavy 6. There's no point in playing the heavy 5 because I can't undercut him, so I do have to intercept him. I might as well play that heavy 6. The question now is, do I let him hit me and fatigue? I might have to do that. I can play heavy 6, in which case he'll definitely undercut me. And if he undercuts me, if he changes tactics and undercuts me, he'll damage my heavy armor. I don't want him to do that. So I will fatigue my heavy 4 move chit this round. He didn't change tactics. He didn't intercept me. So I'll have to fatigue my heavy 4. It's gone. I get my heavy 5 back. Now that's now available to use. Now my weapon's now alerted because I missed. So if he changes tactics, I can undercut him. If not, I have to intercept him, but I can just play my heavy 6 fight chit because I now have an attack time of 3, and I'll keep having that until I intercept him. So I almost certainly have him now. I'm going to protect my maneuver again. If he moves, I can only play heavy 5 as my very fastest now. If he, I don't intercept him or undercut him by him changing tactics, then he can actually wound me through the heavy armor. But if he repositions, and I'm just going to have to take that, and I might get wounded for a few rounds while I'm waiting to intercept him, or for him to change tactics and for me to undercut him. But I think I've still got him. I might just take a little bit of effort. I could get him this round. Got him. The reason I got him, he repositioned, so he didn't intercept me. He did change tactics, that 30% chance, and as soon as he did that, I undercut him with my fight time of 3. He was killed. I get double his fame and notoriety. These were good opponents for me to face. I damaged my shield, and of course I've taken some wounds and some fatiguing. But that's not too bad, considering I've managed to deal with those serpents. So it was a risk not hiding there. That was the worst outcome, was to meet them, but I was still able to take them, which is good. Now, I actually want to get to the guard, and I'm going to have to move right through deep woods to do it. This is now dangerous, because the tremendous serpent is the next in line for a monster roll of 2, and I can't actually take him out. Deep woods is an unknown. I don't know what's in there, but I'm going to move in I'm going to hide once and I'm going to rest twice. It's very important I get rested back as quickly as possible. I'm not going to get through deep woods this turn anyway. It's a long way through, even if I have to stop and hide, search for hidden paths. And I need to get through here if I'm hoping to get to the guard, so I'm going to go through deep woods. Monster die roll of one. My most important chit, as you can have seen, one of my most important chits is my heavy four move. It takes two rest to get it back because it's a two asterisk counter. Nothing summoned to my clearing. Sound chit and a warning chit. Sound chit is Slither. That, as you can see, has summoned the Heavy Dragons, who are another opponent that I am very much capable of taking on. That was the Slither sound chit that summoned them. I can't deal with the next one that turns up, a tremendous dragon. He's beyond my killing range. Bones M was the the warning counter. That's a problem for me. Bones M summons giant bats. Giant bats could well and truly kill the Black Knight, even despite his heavy armour. I don't want to take on a giant bat. Even just one of them could finish me off. The other thing that could turn up at Bone Zem is giants, and they're tremendous. They're beyond my killing range. Although I can take on the heavy dragons, I don't want to be unhidden here, so I must attempt to hide no matter what I do. I'm going to increase my chance. I need to pass through this clearing. So if I move there, I'm going to be blocked. I want to increase my chance of hiding from 70 to 91% by recording two hides. I'll move in and I'll rest another chit. So it doesn't really matter which of these. I can't use either of them. I'll rest the move M5 back from wounded. There's a giant bat. Sorry, it was only one heavy dragon that turned up. There's a giant bat. Oh. I'd be prepared to sit here and take on the heavy dragon, but once I actually took a swing at him, I'd be unhidden and the giant bat could take me out. And that's just way too dangerous. I am going to have a swing at the giant bat, but I'm going to do it in safety. The way I'm going to do that is wait to the end of the second round of combat to take a swing at him. I'd have to undercut him to kill him, to get a hit on him, and I can't do that with his maneuver time of three. The very fastest I can do is three, so I can't undercut him. So I'd have to get an interception, which is a one in three chance. If I swing at the end of the second round of combat, if I hit him, I kill him, and then I'll have to take on the heavy dragon, which I'm more than capable of doing. If I miss him, then two rounds of combat will have ended without fatiguing, wounding, or any death, and combat will end. So it's a safe tactic. There's a 1 in 3 chance of me killing him and then having to face the heavy dragon. There's a 2 in 3 chance of me not intercepting him and combat ending. And that's a safe way to take on a creature that you are not guaranteed to hit and kill, and would cause you a lot of trouble if you missed him. So that's what I'm going to do. There's no point in loading my mace, because I can't undercut him, even with its fast fight time of 3. As soon as I select him, I become unhidden. Now, the bat is extremely dangerous. The reason I don't want to take him on toe-to-toe, even though I can kill him with my mace, is that I've got a 1 in 3 chance of hitting him. And while I'm doing that, of course, the heavy dragon's there. And the heavy dragon's got a 1 in 3 chance of intercepting me. And while he's doing that, the giant bat will undercut me every single turn. And he can't destroy my armor, but every single one of those hits will wound me. And as time goes by, while the heavy dragon's taking swings at me, the giant bat's wounding me every single turn, and I keep missing him because I've only got a 1 in 3 chance of intercepting him, I'll get wounded to death and die. And it's a slow, slow, painful, ignominious death, and I'm not prepared to get into that fight. So I'm going to take this cheap swing at him. It can be a slow fight time, 1 in 3 chance of hitting him, missed, but combat ends. Okay, I'm going to get out of here. I don't want to risk staying hidden here and failing a hide roll here first up and encountering that giant bat. So I'm going to try and get out of deep woods as quickly as possible. The next roll of six will summon two giant bats. So I make sure I record a hide phase. And I'm going to try and get out of this very dangerous tile as quickly as possible. Monster die roll of one. Okay, what's happened with the monster die roll of one? Of course, one is dragons. That heavy dragon prowled, and the tremendous dragon who was next in the queue is summoned to the sound chit. This is an excellent result. I now don't have to worry about that bat. He's not in my clearing this evening. I can take on the heavy dragon all by myself, and he's great prey for me. I alert my wet chit. I can do it with any old counter. Not a problem at all. There's only one of him, so I can might as well attack him now. I select him. He doesn't get an attack on me because I've attacked from hiding. I can overswing with this heavy fight chit, only one asterisk. I've already used the heavy six this round. Of course, I can't use it again, but that time of three will undercut him and kill him. Cheap, easy, guaranteed kill for another five fame and five notoriety. He made a big mistake following me across. I've gone well beyond my week, haven't I? All right, I'll stop it there. Sorry, that was a bit more than a week, but it's been quite successful. I've actually recorded an extra day, but I've managed to satisfy my fame and plus some by killing off denizens, monsters on my way to the ghost. And I'm lucky I met ones that I could deal with. Trolls, heavy dragons, and serpents. And I've accrued quite a bit of fame and notoriety, and I haven't even reached the guard yet, who were my goal. I've had my shield damage, and that's about all that I've come the grief I've encountered. I've recorded an extra day. Sorry, we're a bit beyond a week, but I'll hope you'll join me for the next week to see how the Black Knight goes. Thanks very much.